Good morning, everyone. As always, place your cross on first. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Lord Jesus, I'd like to thank you for waking me up this morning. Thank you for giving me another chance to get it right, Lord Jesus. I ask you to continue to work over me, my wife, our kids, all those who we come in contact with, Lord Jesus. And I ask you to use me as you seem fit to bring forth this word in all honesty and all truth. Send your Holy Spirit of comfort to assist me, to help me, so I can do this exactly how you want me to do it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I opened the two books this morning. At first, I didn't realize why I did it. What I'm going to start off with, Nahum. The Burden of Nineveh, the book of the vision of Nahum, the Elkoshite. God is jealous, and the Lord revengeth. The Lord revengeth and is furious. The Lord will take vengeance on his adversaries, and he reserveth wrath for his enemies. The Lord is slow to anger and great in power, and will not at all acquit the wicked. The Lord hath his way in the whirlwind and in the storm, and the clouds are the dust of his feet. He rebuketh the sea and maketh it dry, and drive up all the rivers. Bashan languisheth, and Carmel, and the flower of Lebanon languisheth. The mountains quake at him, and the hills melt, and the earth is burdened at his presence, yea, the world, and all that dwell therein. First thing you're going to realize is, God created everything. He's in control of all everything. You're going to pay attention to this world right now. People love to say the universe. They think the universe covers them. You know, who's the creator of the universe? And one thing I done realized something in the Bible. I done read the Bible a few times, and I never see the universe in there, like the universe, giving unto the universe. I never seen that. That's some new age things. You know, be careful with that word, the universe. I think people figure if they say the universe, that covers God too. So if there is a God, by me saying the universe, I'm actually giving honor to him. No, God wants you to give honor to him separate. Who can stand before his indignation, and who can abide in the fierceness of his anger? His fury is poured out like fire, and the rocks are thrown down by him. The Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knoweth them that trust in him. But with an overrunning flood, he will make an utter end of this place, of the place thereof, and darkness shall pursue his enemies. What do you imagine against the Lord? He will make an utter end. Affliction shall not rise up the second time. For while they be folded together as thorns, and while they are drunken as drunkards, they shall be devoured as stubble fully dry. There is one come out of thee that imagineth evil against the Lord, a wicked counselor. Thus saith the Lord, though they be quiet, and likewise many, yet thus shall they be cut down. When he shall pass through, though I have afflicted thee, I will afflict thee no more. For now will I break his yoke from off thee, and will burst thy bonds in sunder. And the Lord hath given commandment concerning thee, that no more of thy name be sown. Out of the house of thy gods will I cut off the graven image and the molten image. I will make thy grave, for thou art vile. Behold upon the mountains the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publisheth peace. O Judah, keep thy solemn feast, perform thy vows, for the wicked shall no more pass through thee. He is utterly cut off. Now, I just wanted to read that little part. Now, you got to think about what's going on here. God's wrath is reserved for the wicked. And guess what? We were wicked. But they said that God is slow to anger. He's trying to tell them the problems with graven images and all these things, right? Let's put it this way. When we're living away from God, he's constantly trying to reach us. But you got two things that's going to happen in your life. You're going to convert and change back to God, or you're going to end up feeling his wrath. And that's what you don't want. You understand? We all in our life was inching close to God's wrath. When we give our life to God, something happens. A change takes place. His wrath is no longer for you. He said, you either for me or against me. So once you start living for God, guess what? You got to worry about the wrath. You understand? Only the wicked have to worry about that. And the thing is, he's constantly trying to reach them too. That's why he got this Bible. That's why he got people that spread the word. And that's why he got people that try to tell other people, hey man, something wrong here. You might want to make some changes. But anyway, let's go to Thessalonians. Let's see something. This is going to really help you out a lot. I think it was Thessalonians 1. Thessalonians 1. Paul and Silvanus and Timothy is unto the church of Thessalonians, which is in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord of Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God always for you, always making mention of you in our prayers. Remember without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father, knowing, brethren, beloved, your election of God. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance, as you know what manner of men we are were among you for your sake. And you became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost, so that we were examples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. For from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith to God is spread abroad, so that we need not to speak anything. For they themselves show us what manner of entering in we had unto you, and how you turn to God from idols to serve your true God, serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, which he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. Did you hear that? Delivered us from the wrath to come. What am I getting at, people? I'm not finna tell you God ain't done with you yet. I'm not gonna tell you that. I'm not gonna tell you you still got time. I'm not gonna tell you that. But I'm gonna tell you this one thing. As long as you have breath in your mouth, you can make a change. You see, if what he's talking about in Thessalonians, he's talking about how faithful they are, how good they are, how they desire the word, how they spread the word, and how all this. But then he said through something in the end, that you change from your worshiping of idols. They changed. And then he said, he ended with the wrath. You see, if they wouldn't have changed and started living for God, they would have faced the same wrath that God talks about in Nahum. You know, nobody likes to hear about the wrath of God. Nobody does. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't bother me. I'm going to tell you why, because the fear of the Lord is beginning of understanding. You know, knowing that God is all powerful and all great and all loving, but you can't, knowing also that you can't take advantage of his love is a good thing. God does not play the radio. You understand? Don't take his slow to anger, for granted. Don't take it for granted. I always tell the story of Moses and the people who dedicated their lives to God, and then they decided to turn from their good ways to evil. They went backwards. And I'm sure they was thinking like, well, God has helped us so many times in the wilderness. He's just gonna let us go. He's just gonna give us a pat on the back like he always done. You know, we can stay complaining and stay doing this. We can stay making graven images and doing these things. And I guess this one time they thought for sure that they still had time left. And Moses posed them with a simple question, a simple solution. Hey, turn to God or desire to go back. And a lot of people is like, well, I'm going to go back. You understand? And I bet for a second that it was like, okay, we good. You know, God is... He's asking us if we want to go back or not. You know, it's kind of like a, it's not really a trick question. It's a question to see where your heart is. You see, God is not slack concerning his promises, and God is not slack concerning the things he says about people entering into his wrath and slow to anger. Think about it. The story of Egypt, the children of Israel leaving Egypt was a slow process. You understand? God dealt with all their bickering, all their complaining, all their desire, won't meet, won't this and that. But you got to understand there's a moment when God is like, enough is enough. You understand? Enough is enough. Come on, change from your ways. You understand? And like this time, in the book of Exodus, they felt they had some more time. I don't know what they was thinking. You know, like, when you take God's words slightly, like, hey, well, God is a loving God. He's a loving God. So he's going to give me as much time as I need to get right. The thing is, you don't know his time. You don't know his timing. You understand? You don't know his timing. Why do you think the people of Nineveh took what Jonah told them to heart? Because what was going to happen? The wrath of God was going to come on the people of Nineveh. The wrath of God was coming that way. What changed God's mind? Returning to him. Returning to him. That's what helped them. And then once you return to him, you love him so much, you spread his word. Let's go back to Thessalonians. You love him so much. And now you can tell other people, hey man, you know, I used to do that stuff that you do, but I don't anymore. I believe in the true God now. I don't believe in that idol worship. I don't believe in the universe. You understand? Forget all that science. You understand? Come on now. That's simple. And you know why people this day and age feel there's no God? Because guess what? God is slow to anger. But don't take that for granted. Don't take his slow to anger for granted. Because there's two things. There's two things that can happen to you. You understand? You can die in that sin. He said there's an evil man that prolongs his life, and there's a good man that dies young. So what you trying to tell you? What are you trying to tell you? Some evil people can die in their sins, and some good people can die young. You understand? So what's worse? To live old, to live old age and do wickedness and idol worship your whole life and die in that sin? That's not a good thing. You understand? What the Bible says in the New Testament, they live lavishly on this earth. You understand? Some of the cries of the poor who they have defrauded had came and has reached my eyes. One thing about it, when people pray, you know, when we pray for our enemies, you understand, we pray for them to change. We're not praying for them to be destroyed. But we also know this, Lord, let your will be done, not mine. You see, that stopped you from trying to curse folks. I'm telling you, it's some curses out there. People curse, people don't even realize it. Praying for their enemies' downfall. You know, I get in the habit of like, touch their heart, touch their soul. Because sometimes when I'm mad, and you know this too, when you're mad, you might say some things that you shouldn't say. So keep it simple, sweet. He said, bless and not curse. You understand? Yes, you read Psalms a lot of times, and you see where all David's enemies were destroyed. David destroyed him. Let's put it this way. They had their chance too, to serve the living God. All of them did. You understand? You think Goliath didn't get a chance to serve God? He did. Everybody did. There's not a soul alive that don't have a chance to serve God. Because Jesus died for all of our sins. So he given all us a chance to turn from our wicked ways and serve him, the true God. There are no other gods. That's part of the Ten Commandments. You know, I done talked with people who love God, but I ain't finished yet. I done talked to people who love God. Love them. Love them. Love them. Or so they say. But the word says one thing. He said, if you love me, keep my commands. Keep my words. Keeping something means you stay true to it, right? But I hear people say they love God. They love God. And then they'll turn around and be like, well, I talked to some friends. They say there are other gods. And they don't find God the way we do. And they agree with them. And I'm like, how can you agree with that if you love God? If you love God, you love the truth. So instead of agreeing with your friend that says there are other gods, you might want to tell them the truth. Now you're blending in. What, you trying not to piss somebody off or something? You understand? You trying not to upset somebody? Read what Paul did when he was over there in Rome or Athens, and those people were trying to offer up sacrifices for them, trying to say they Jupiter and he's Mars. And Paul was like, no, no, no. Something wrong here. No, don't do this. Don't do this. You as a child of God, it's your God-given duty to warn people because it can save their life. You don't warn them, not only are they gonna face his wrath, you are. Deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father which is in heaven. Do you think the scripture lies when it says, many will come to me on that faithful day. Many will come for me. Come to me. Lord, haven't I done this and that in your name? You understand? Haven't I helped the poor? Haven't I did this and that? Depart from me, you that work iniquity. And the thing is, it's so similar, because you tell the people who are going to make it the exact same thing. Whenever you fed me, whenever I hunger, whenever I thirst, when you did it to the least of them, you did it to me. Do you understand what I'm saying? Really pay attention to the word of God. How do you try to bring change in an evil world? You tell them what changed you. Let's go back to Thessalonians. So, at the beginning of this scripture, you don't hear nothing about idol worship at all. You just hear how good and faithful this servant is, and how they know the Holy Spirit and the word is working in him, and he's spreading the word all the time. His works are being known. You understand? And then he says, God has changed you from the worship of idols to worshiping the true God. You understand? Then he's talking about the wrath again. You got to warn people. Think about it. If Paul and the other disciples didn't tell that man in Thessalonians at the beginning of the book about God, he would have probably faced the wrath. But he didn't, because he changed. So what happens if you don't change? You face the wrath. And you can't be no secondhand follower of Christ. You can't be in agreement with everyone. That's a people pleaser. You understand? I'm telling you, I saw this with my own eyes. Yeah, I talked to some of my Indian friends, and they believe that there are other gods and out there, and they get God to get to God like that. Aren't you a Christian? So you just let your friends persuade you to go against your religion, to go against the Bible. That's not how it's supposed to work, people. You tell people the truth. If you love them, you tell them the truth. You understand? And the thing is, by coming into agreement with people on certain things, ain't helping the situation. It's not. You got to tell them. You know, the thing about it, everybody knows God. How do you know everybody know God? When he went to Nineveh, you understand? When he went to this place, they knew God. They just fell away for a while. But they needed reassurance. They needed something to put them back on track. They needed a warning. You understand? A warning. And guess what? If they wouldn't have took heed to that warning, what would have happened? I'm just being real with you. He said, 7 days, I will destroy this place. God said, 7 days, I will destroy this place. I will destroy Nineveh, like he did Gomorrah. Now, let's put it this way. In Gomorrah, he gave them the same. He had Abraham up there vouching for the people. Gave them the same example. The only thing about it, he didn't warn them with the mouth. He warned them with deeds. He tested their actions. He weighed their actions. What happened upon the children, the angels, when they entered Gomorrah or Sodom? They were approached by men, not to greet them lovingly, not to greet them kindly, but to lie with them, to rape them, to take advantage of another man. Come out there so we can get to know them. Not get to know them like, hey man, where you from? You know, how you doing today? You know, welcome to our wonderful town. Their actions determine their fate. Now, imagine if 8 of those people would have came out there, 8 people, when they saw these men, they would have treated them with respect and honor. And according to scripture, guess what? Sodom would have been saved. God was looking for 8 righteous people in that town. 8. Couldn't find 8. All he had was 1, 2, 3. You see, even what's kind of, I ain't gonna say he lied, because they could have been virgins. But he was basically saying, I got 2 daughters here that you can take. Just don't do this thing. And if you come to find out the truth, the 2 daughters were married. Their husbands didn't even want to go. He told the husbands too. You understand? No, man. You see, there was warnings there. He told them, y'all need to come with us. So that would have been 2 souls gained. If those 2 sons, right, and his wife, if her heart was right, Look, 1, 2. That's 2 right there. Husband, wife, that's 2. His 2 daughters, 2. 6. The husband and wife, that would have been 6 people. So if 2 other people outside that door would have showed them 6 right there, I mean them 8, God would have spared it. But no, they didn't change. And I'm telling you, let's put it this way. How long you think Sodom was around? Probably a while. It wasn't no quick wrath. It wasn't like, oh, one person messed up, I'm finna destroy this place. By no means. That's not how God works. That's not how God works. This place was so tarnished and so wicked. God had to pour out his wrath on them. And I trust God's judgment. I'm okay with it. You understand? Because if you do the math, that wickedness probably would have spread and spread and spread and spread. It had spread because it was 2 cities. It wasn't just 1 city that was destroyed. It was Sodom and Gomorrah. People forget that part. It was 2 cities destroyed in that great and faithful day. 2 cities. You understand? So what we think is different now. You see, one thing you're going to realize something about reading Nahum. Let me pause for a second. I will continue.